Hello everyone, I am Dr. Sridhar Raj. Today we are going to understand about All India Services and the Central Services. The objectives of this session are to understand the evolution of All India Services and Central Services, to understand the constitutional status of the civil services in India, to understand the importance of All India Services for both the central and the state governments, to understand how the All India Services and the Central Services help in the execution of the public policies. Evolution. The origin of modern public services in India can be traced back to the early years of our national movement, when the educated Indians were eager to play their role in the administrative system of our country. Prominent national leaders like Raja Ram Mohan Roy, Gopalakrishna Gokhale, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Syed Ahmed Khan, Surendranath Banerjee, Motilal Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru, Pandit Madan Mohan Malavya, Subhash Chandra Bose and others emphasized the need for Indianization of the public services. The East India Company, which has ruled India for over two centuries, did not realize the necessity of inducting Indians into the public services. It was only after 1885, with the establishment of the Indian National Congress, that Indians could find a place in the administration of the government. It was only in the year 1919 that provision for setting up of a regular service commission was made to recruit personnel for carrying out administration of the government of India. It was in 1926 that the first central commission was constituted. It marks a memorable occasion in the history of administration in India. Later, the Government of India Act 1935 has provided for setting up of a federal service commission on a regular basis. As our constitution has provided for a federal system in India, two sets of public services were introduced. They are one for the union and the other for the states. Besides, there are All India Services which are common to both the union and the states. The union services, also known as the central services, concerned with the administration of subjects provided in the union list. The officers working in these services are exclusively under the control of the union government. They are recruited specifically for this purpose and do not possess the option to be deputed in the states. The state public services administer the subjects enumerated in the state list and render assistance to the political executive. The officers of these services are under the control of the respective state governments. Article 315 of the Indian Constitution makes it obligatory for the union and each constituent state of the Indian Union to have a separate public service commission. A joint public service commission is also constituted for two or more states. The president may entrust the Union Public Service Commission with the job of fulfilling the needs of a state on a request of the state governor. Importance. Public services occupy a vital position in the administrative system of a country. They have become a universal phenomenon as no government can work without them. According to Herman Feiner, Public services comprise a professional body of officials, permanent, paid, and skilled. Public services do not include the officials of legislature, judiciary, and army. Further, personnel working in various local bodies also do not strictly form part of the public services, as they are controlled by their own organizations. Public services possess 5 characteristics, namely permanence, neutrality, anonymity, professional commitment, and impartiality. Public service officials are the paid and the permanent employees. They maintain neutrality in politics. They remain anonymous and assist the political executive in the formulation and the implementation of public policies. They render advice and provide necessary secretarial and professional assistance to the ministers concerned. So, the efficiency of the government depends to a large extent on the competence of the public service officials. Rationale of All India Services. The All India Services are those services which are common for both the central and the state governments. It means that these services work under both the central and the state governments. They can be deputed either to the central and the state governments. The central and the state governments exchange these officers quite often to reap the benefits of their rich expertise and experience. The arguments put forward in favor of the All India Services are national integration. They promote national integration as the members of these services possess an All India outlook. As they are usually posted in states other than their own, they can function beyond the regional, linguistic, and communal interests. Efficiency. They help in maintaining high standard of administration in terms of administrative efficiency in the center as well as in the states. During the British period, they were called the steel frame of administrative structure. Uniformity. They help to ensure uniformity of the administrative system throughout the nation. The members of these services are rotated between the center and the states. Cooperative federalism. They facilitate liaison, cooperation, coordination, and joint action on the issues and problems of common interest between the center and the states. Repository of talent. They attract the best talent in the country due to the wide field of recruitment, high remuneration, status, and prestige. President's rule. When the president's rule is in operation in any state, he can depend on the loyalty and cooperation of these officers for efficient administration. This is because they are appointed and removed only by the president of India. Independence. They promote independence and impartiality of civil service at the highest level. As members of these services enjoy the constitutional safeguards, they are free from regional and local pressures and influences. Hence, they can afford to give free and frank advice to the state ministers. Rich experience. They facilitate the interchange of rich experience among different states. It must be mentioned here that the officers of All India Services serve not only the state governments and central government, but the union territories and local governments as well, both urban and rural. Thus, their rich experience can be used for the benefit of the whole country. Beneficial to states, the talent mobilized through national recruitment to these services is distributed among the states. Hence, the states which are deficient in their manpower supply to fill the high and strategic positions will be benefited. Continuity. They are the continuation of the old administrative arrangement developed during the British period. The members of these services during the British rule constituted the highest rung of the administrative hierarchy. The IAS, The only multi-purpose All India Services is the direct descendant of the erstwhile ICS, which was called as the Heaven Born Service. All India Services, the All India Services are those services which are common to both the central and the state governments. It must be mentioned here that the central and the state governments have their separate services called the central services and the state services respectively. Thus, the All India Services are in addition to the central and the state services. At present, there are three All India Services. They are the Indian Administrative Service, which is called IAS, the Indian Police Service, which is called IPS, the Indian Forest Service, that is called IFS. In 1947, the Indian Civil Service ICS was replaced by IAS, and the Imperial Police IP was replaced by IPS and was recognized by the Constitution of All India Services. In 1963, three more All India Services were created. They are the Indian Forest Service, the Indian Medical and Health Service, and finally the Indian Service of Engineers. However, out of these three, only the Indian Forest Service came into existence in the year 1966. At present, there are only three All India Services, IAS, IPS and IFS. Article 312 of the Constitution authorizes the Parliament of India to create new All India Services on the basis of a resolution passed by the Rajya Sabha to that effect. Thus, a new All India Service can be created only by an act of Parliament and not by a resolution of Rajya Sabha. However, the Parliament cannot do so without the recommendation of Rajya Sabha. This power is given to the Rajya Sabha to protect the interests of the states in the Indian federal system. Interestingly, the drafting committee of the Constituent Assembly did not provide a constitutional status to the All India Services. Accordingly, the draft constitution did not make any mention of the All India Services. However, the Constituent Assembly included provisions with respect to the All India Services which were approved. These provisions under Article 312 not only gave a constitutional status to the All India Services but also provided for the creation of new All India Services. Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel was the chief protagonist of All India Services in the Constituent Assembly. Hence, he came to be regarded as the father of All India Services. The All India Services Act of 1951 authorized the central government to make rules in consultation with the state governments for the regulation of recruitment and service conditions of the members of All India Services. It must be mentioned here that irrespective of their division among different states, each of these All India Services form a single service with common rights and status and uniform scales of pay throughout the country. All the three All India Services are Class 1 or Group A services. The All India Services have three categories. They are Super Time Scale, Senior Scale and Junior Scale. In the beginning, the officers are appointed in the Junior Scale. In the course of time, they are placed in the Senior Scale and the Super Time Scale. The three All India Services are managed and controlled by three different ministries of the central government. They are the Indian Administrative Service by the Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pensions, the Indian Police Service by the Ministry of Home, and the Indian Forest Service by the Ministry of Environment and Forests. It must be mentioned here that the All India Services are controlled jointly by the central and the state governments. The ultimate control lies with the central government, while the immediate control vests with the state governments. Their salaries and pensions are met by the states, but the disciplinary action, that is imposition of penalties against these officers, can only be taken by the central government. Constitutional provisions. The Constitution of India makes the following provisions with regard to the recruitment and service conditions of the All India and Central Services. Article 309 empowers the Parliament to regulate the recruitment and service conditions of persons appointed to Central Services and posts. Article 310 provides that the members of All India Services and Central Services and posts hold office during the pleasure of the President. Article 311 provides that no member of All India Services and Central Services and posts shall be dismissed or removed by an authority subordinate to that by which he was appointed. Article 312 authorizes the Parliament to create new All India Services, including an All India Judicial Service, and regulate the recruitment and service conditions of persons appointed to these services. However, they can be created by the Parliament only after the Rajya Sabha passes a resolution supported by 2/3 majority saying that it is necessary in the national interest to do so. It also says that the services known at the commencement of the Constitution as the Indian Administrative Service and the Indian Police Service shall be deemed to be services created by Parliament under this article. Moreover, the All India Judicial Service shall not include any post inferior to that of a district judge. Though the 42nd Amendment in the year 1976 made the provision for the creation of All India Judicial Service, no such law has been made so far. Article 323A authorizes Parliament to provide for the setting up of an administrative tribunal for the adjudication or trial of disputes and complaints with respect to recruitment and service conditions of persons appointed to Central Services and posts. Article 335 lays down that the claims of the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes shall be taken into consideration in making appointments to the Central Services and the posts. Central Services. The personnel of Central Services work under the exclusive jurisdiction of the central government. They man specialized functional and technical positions in various departments of the central government. Most of them are controlled and managed by their respective ministries and departments. While a few of them are controlled and managed by the Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pensions. This ministry also determines the general policies pertaining to all the central services. In fact, the Ministry of Personnel, Public Grievances and Pensions is the central personnel agency in the Government of India. Before independence, the central services were classified into class 1, class 2, subordinate and inferior services. The nomenclature of subordinate and inferior services was replaced by class 3 and class 4 services on the recommendation of the first pay commission in the year 1946 and 1947. Again in the year 1974, the classification of central services into class 1, class 2, class 3 and class 4 was changed to group A, group B, group C and group D respectively. This was done on the recommendation of the third pay commission in the year 1970 and 1973. Thus, as of now, the central services, that is both established as well as general, are classified into four categories. They are central services group A, central services group B, central services group C, central services group D. The number of group A central service has been increasing over the years from 30 in 1971, 49 in 1984 to 59 in 1996, the latest year for which published data is available. It must also be mentioned here that the Indian Foreign Service, that is called IFS, is the topmost central service in terms of prestige, status, pay and emoluments. In fact, Though a central service competes with all India services in position, status and pay scales, it comes next to the IAS in ranking and its pay scale is higher than the IPS. It is managed by the Ministry of External Affairs. Its recruits serve the Indian missions and embassies abroad. The future of All India Services and Central Services, the All India Services and the Central Services have their origin during the British rule and owe their existence to the colonial regime. The role of All India Services and Central Services is commendable given their contribution to the nation building and other developmental activities. In fact, the nascent democracy could survive the pangs of partition due to the commendable work done by these services during the early years. However, the biggest criticism is that these services have also added the bureaucratic culture. The bureaucratic culture has not only slowed down the growth and development of the country, but also hindered the access of basic services to the citizens in the country. However, things started to change with the advent of liberalization, privatization, and globalization, which is often termed as LPG. That apart, the advent of information and communication technologies, that's called ICTs, also ushered a change in civil service. Given the external changes, the civil services have also altered their way of doing the business. Their business changed, which helped to provide better services to the citizens. Individuals with exceptional talents are joining the civil services and also helping the civil service structure to become more modern and goal-driven. In fact, the civil servants have now become the harbingers of change and better services to the citizens. Change from governance to e-governance has drastically altered the functioning of the civil service in the country. As governance process has undergone tremendous change, the IT, that is information technology, has made the process of governance simpler, easier and faster, which made the civil service more agile and efficient in the delivery of public services to the citizens. E-governance has also helped the civil service in India to become more citizen friendly and also adopt the best practices from the corporate world, particularly those related to technology. All these changes have made civil service truly citizen friendly in the last two decades. Summing up, the civil services are normally not given the constitutional status in any country, but given the social and economic and political conditions of the years of independence, the leaders felt that these services should be provided some constitutional status. Accordingly, the All India Services, which are considered as the bulwark of independence, integrity and honesty, have found their place in the Indian Constitution. These All India Services, along with the other central services, have done commendable job in the government of the country, from capital city of the country to the remote villages. Some of the model questions are: 1. Give a brief description of the evolution of the All India Services. 2. Give a brief description of the evolution of central services. 3. How do you think that the All India Services are helpful for the central and the state governments?